is a statue of King Ur-Nama. It's inscribed in Sumerian, and it's believed to be from around circa 2100 BCE. Ur-Nama was the first king of the third dynasty of Ur. A close friend of mine sent me this image when I ran into her in New York the weekend of the women's marches just after the inauguration. And the image has really been imprinted on my mind. The significance of the statue holding this bowl on its head was that Ur-Nama was responsible for the restoration of old temples and oversaw the extensive construction of new temples, especially the step towers that we know as ziggurats that many of us love from the works of Kirk Menges. The figure depicts the king carrying a basket of clay that will be used to make the temple's bricks. In fact, the very first brick that went into the building of the temple was always made by the king himself. This idea of the king as a basket carrier is meant to be a role that shows the most supreme being in the society as the lowliest of occupations in ancient Mesopotamia. The idea was that in the presence of the gods, the king was a humble servant. His act of labor was meant not only to connect him to his people, but also to the sense of piety that they were meant to observe. And I think what was so impactful about this is that this is a spirit of leadership that we are in so much need of today. And it really also represents all of you out here. I want to say that I also appreciate the fact that Chris reached out to Jerry Saltz and asked him to be our keynote this year, and I think in many ways Jerry himself embodies this spirit. You know, he didn't choose to or have an opportunity to earn a formal academic background, but when he was granted an honorary doctorate by the Art Institute of Chicago, he was said to have asked if they couldn't have made him a cardiologist instead. Another thing that I really admire that Jerry has said is that if criticism is marginalized, then it's the best thing that could ever happen. It means that critics have to write better to get the reader's respect, and that they're free to write whatever they want. Since 2006, he's been the senior art critic and columnist for New York Magazine. He was the art critic for The Village Voice, and he's been nominated for the Pulitzer Prize in Criticism 3 times. He's also served as a visiting critic at the School of Visual Arts, Columbia University, Yale University, and the School of the Art Institute of Chicago, as well as the New York Studio Residency Program. He was also the sole advisor for the 1995 Whitney Biennial. Jerry, we're truly honored to have you here. Thank you.
Thank you. Ow. Can you hear me? Okay. Hello, NCECA. First, I do want to thank Chris Stanley, Josh Green, Paul Sacroides. Don't hate me so fast. And Dory Nelson for really helping me get here. And I'm really grateful to all of you. Hello, people of the mud. I've heard you can be a tough room. I've heard you can be a good room. I'm going to do the best I can. Okay, I'm an art critic, you know that? I hope so. How many of you here follow me on Instagram? Hey, right? I'd like you to follow me. Because I think you would have some fun. It's a lot of politics, and it doesn't ruin your day too much. And then a lot of naughty pictures. I never post photos of naked people, just works of art that might be questionable. Whoops, I forgot my notes, sorry. I want to talk about politics for a minute. It's a tough time. I want to say you're lucky, but we're not. This is really, for me, kind of an emergency, the same way it is for you. There's really not much of a difference. So what's an artist to do? Does art matter? Well, I think that's like asking if love matters. It's always been here. It doesn't change with an emergency. Our forebears have all had emergencies. They happen. We think we're living in one right now. Can you all hear me back there? Can you hear me? Okay. Artists don't have a heart attack. Listen to me. Go into your studios. If people tell you to make political art, what I would tell them is, I already am. You are alive right now, whether you're painting tulips, making boxes. Some people here even make triangles. Who are the triangle people? Hey! They're very political, triangle person. Thank you for that. But I actually mean that, because anybody that is alive right now is experiencing the moment, whether it's an ignorance of the moment, a love of the moment, acting unoriginally about the moment. I cannot tell you how much bad Trump art I've already seen. And you know what? Your job is to make about 8 of those, right? You put a cat's anus by his mouth. Oh, sometimes it's funny. Other times it doesn't work. Always send them to your friends first before you send them to Jerry Saltz. Because I've had to email in the middle of the night back to people going, this is pretty shit, you know? This isn't going to cut it. But your job is to do some of it intentionally. The rest, you don't need to coax. It's coming out of you already. Most of you were already channeling it before the it happened. Look at your work for it, the signs, the clues. I've seen it in a lot of art. I expect I'll be seeing a lot more of it. And listen to me carefully, please, on this. Don't turn on your own kind. We need each other right now. We need each other bad. And then we can go back. Look at the art world, which you're in, goddammit. The art world is like high school with money, basically. Okay? I never sat at the popular table. Did you? No. You're a little younger than me, and you still remember that. Did you sit at the popular table? Nobody here did. You're all... You're smelly shamans, to be honest with you. You have to wear, there's a woman right there. She has to have her magic hat on in order to go to the studio. An old painter named Rembrandt had to do that too. Whenever you see Rembrandt's self-portraits, it's this like weird Jew. Sitting, you know, and his nose has gotten too big. He was very famous, and then he wasn't. If you painted that dark, you would fall out of favor, too. Don't lie. Don't lie. You've gone, like, to great museums and sometimes looked at Rembrandt and go, it's kind of brown. I can't really see what the hell is in it. But as with Velázquez, you're seeing the reverberations of being human in his work. And when you get quiet, and I'd say it would happen in Piero, probably Cézanne, some early Agnes Martins, you start to feel those reverberations of something Shakespearean, right? A lot of times you're listening to Shakespeare going, what the hell is he talking about? Except the English people are all like, oh, I so understand this. I saw you. Okay. Rembrandt had to wear his secret stupid hat to paint. That's why he's always wearing that silly thing. You have your own rituals. You have to clean the studio first. Your studio's a fucking mess. I stopped making studio visits in November 1998 for two reasons. That was the month that I got my first weekly art criticism job. Being an art critic is great. I never went to school. Anybody here have no degrees like this loser? I love you. I love you, losers. Loser. Huh? I was desperate to be in your world. But I was an asshole, as you can tell. I try not to be at home, especially, but your nature. I never went to school. I'm a little ashamed of it, which is why I make the big deal about whenever I get a honorary PhD. And now my wife, who spoke to you guys, and some of you say my wife, Roberta Smith, if you know her, she's the real fucking deal. I mean, I'm user-friendly, but whoa, right? I love my work. I love me. But you're all going to have to pass through the duodenum of Roberta somehow, because she's Quaker and she can't lie. You don't want to sleep with Quakers, really. It's a pain. No, it's just, oh, God. They always tell the truth. Oh, my God. A Jew with a Quaker. It's a disaster. Why, are you in a relationship like that? It's a disaster, right? Okay. What was I talking about? Roberta came here and said she loved you very much, but also said she had a hard time, things went funny. I hope they don't with me. All of you are called to make your work. I would tell all artists not to be artists. Don't be an artist unless you really, 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 really have to be. Because you're going to spend a real lot of time alone, ungodly amounts of time alone until you love it in a diseased way. Right now, we're out here with each other in public, but we're barely functioning. I was talking to Chris about it. He said, I don't know how you do it, Jerry. I said, I don't know either. And I stopped making studio visits in November 1998 with no degrees. I was a long-distance truck driver. This. Do you believe it? It's true. It's really true. I drove from New York to Florida and New York to Texas. Once a month, I would do those trips. We used to have a thing called the CB radio then. My handle was the Jewish cowboy. And I would try to be funny and get... Maybe they were all ceramicists, because they weren't laughing. No, just kidding. And I would come on and go, Breaker 19, you want to talk about the late work of Carl Andre. And never worked once. anyway, I was a long-distance truck driver, and I really wanted to be what you are. In this world that we complain about all damn day, and I wanted it bad, until finally, I realized one day, whatever I was going through could not be worse than not trying. Jasper John said an amazing thing. You do everything you can do until you are helpless to do the thing that you have to do. So, in your work, you will become like an bad abstract expressionist for a few years. You'll make some bad Trump art. And then you will have a dream the way Jasper Johns did. In 1954, a gay 24-year-old man from the South who had been tossed from family to family. I'm not an orphan, but I'm told by orphans that go from family to family to family, that's pretty hard. Because nobody wants you, is the message you're getting, right? I hate parents myself. I'm from that generation. You kids fucking need to individuate from your goddamn parents. Don't hate me. Don't hate me, because they're trying to love you to fucking death, okay? I love them. I love mom and dad. Jasper Johns, this gay man, comes to New York, didn't go to school. He went to school one day, actually, and then quit. And he went to New York, was hanging out, finding himself, and he woke up one morning and he said, I dreamt I painted the American flag, and so I did. What did you dream last night? A whole career might have been given to you last night in your dumb dream. Imagine how awful it must have been for Johns, while everybody else in 1953, 1954, 1955 is making abstract paintings, and Jackson Pollock, who's a great artist, and de Kooning is a great artist. If you want to read my favorite artist biography is the one on de Kooning. The man never said a dumb thing, ever. Every quote out of that guy's mouth is like gold. The only other artist I've seen like that is Rauschenberg, is that way. They're so stupid that they're geniuses. Don't, you know, I love them. He had to paint a flag like Betsy Ross. He had to do it in the oldest painting medium of all, in honey, heated, in caustic. Why? Matisse's brushstrokes are about this long, right? And they're some of the longest brushstrokes in all of art. You know why that is? Because you're all nervous wrecks. Because the second you do this, you're like, oh my God. You know? Most of, here, you want to know a short brushstroke? Think about Giacometti. Right? Picasso didn't ever get much longer than that. Well, Picasso said, you can hate him. I think he's great. I think Picasso only got better. Academics will tell you after about the 1920s, once the Mount Everests of cubism and synthetic cubism and all of that were over, the academics will basically say, that's the end of Picasso. They don't like Matisse much either afterwards. I would tell you that both only got better because both, like you, keep making your work. It doesn't matter if the time moves on from what you're making, you don't have much of a choice. If you're still making triangles while everybody else is making rectangles, you better figure out, do do you really love those triangles? Can you make those triangles completely yours? Or are you doing it as laziness? You guys really have to work. May I say the one thing to ceramicists in the room? Are there any? By the way, last night in the hotel, I learned something about ceramicists. I thought they like are all hippy dippy, drinking tea. You're raging alcoholics. And you're so sexy and physical with each other. I don't mean you're like boinking everybody, but no, honest to God, they were all like, hey, how you doing? Oh, I'm okay. I love you. Give me this. Every hand I shake from, I was terrified this afternoon. Anybody here shake my hand? They're like, this guy broke my hand right there. And writers have the weakest hands in the world because we all have carpal tunnel syndrome. And you got all the sexuality. I was like, these people are animals. They're hot. And I don't have affairs and things like that, but I honestly was looking at all of them going, I could have sex with these people. I really was. Who was the woman in the elevator with me that I went up? That was you? And then we got off on the same floor. And I was really thinking the whole walk, and then we went down the same way. And I was thinking, in my 20s, boom! Really? Ceramicists are fucking hot. I wanted to be you today. But I mean this from the bottom of my heart. Because of the physicality, because of the amazing tools, I bought about 15 tools today. I could be so famous, I was thinking. It's so easy, you know? And I'm gonna put them on my shelves and my wife will love me for this. Here's my only advice, and I've been telling this to all my students and it's worked. Some of them have gotten into the Whitney Biennials, others are famous. Don't call yourself a ceramicist. I know, this is where the talk goes south. Jerry tanked. You know what I call you? Artist. Thank you. You're sculptors, you assholes. What is this? It's like when I meet in other schools, in other conferences, a painter that uses fabric doesn't say, I'm a macrameist, motherfuckers. I mean, let's get our priorities straight, okay? Don't define yourself only by medium. You can't stop the painters, fuck them, okay? I'm a painter. We're the oldest art. And then the people of the mud go. On my own, I have learned a lot about cave painting and cave art. I would first of all recommend, is anybody here who has seen any in person in the flesh? Look around and tell me if it wasn't among the most powerful experiences you ever had. Yes. I would submit to you that those painters were artists. We know that What's the second most common, what's the first most common thing in the caves? First. Mammals. Wouldn't it have been great if they painted people? But they didn't. It would have been great to watch them like eating baklava after dinner, of like going out on the hunt, of coming back home to watch whatever they watched, right? We think that 1% of 1% of 1% of 1% of all cave art survives today. That makes perfect sense. Do you know that in order for a cave painting to survive, it cannot change temperature by more than 3 degrees over the last 35,000 years? If at any point it freezes or gets too warm, either or, the paint loosens that season from the wall and will all come off over the ensuing millennia. So it's very rare. The first most common thing is mammals, and I would say that mammals have never been rendered better in the history of our species. They were artists. From incredible observation, from 100,000 years of looking at mammals. That's why they painted them. What's the second most common thing in the caves? The handprints. And I'm sure all of you use this on your own pots, but you know how they made them. They're the first photographs. You get some colored sap, something sticky, in other words, that will be a binder. You put it in your mouth, just like you do, instead of those ball roller bullshit things with your glazes and your, God damn it. You're all medieval, right? You're alchemists, but I'm saying we have older history than even your alchemy. And you can go all the way back, and here's what they did. They would go, spit and remove the hand. And you know what we've learned now from studying every single hand in every cave. You've read, right? 51% of them are women. We made up a great story. Men are great. You gotta love us. Oh, God. We fucked up a little here, but we made up a great story that only shamans could go in the cave. You know, and make magic. Uh-uh. We know that half the people in the caves were women. What's the third most common thing in the caves? This man is applauding. Vulvas and phalluses. Thousands of them. And a lot of them are stupid, drawn the same way you did when you were a little kid. The same way you would look up a dirty word. Or now my goddaughters both tell me, I was worrying about them when they were young, and they said, Godfather, we've seen every sexual act that you can imagine online, and I was like, holy shit! What would that have done to me? I feel that I would have been a better person for this. I think half of us in this room are fucked up because, well, half of you in the room didn't see your parents naked. Oh, the woman in the hat again. And you're fucked up for it. And the other half of the people in this room did see their parents naked, and you're fucked up. So it's hopeless. Penises and vulvas mean that the kids were in the caves too, and that many of these caves were not caves at the time. The geological forces changed continents, oceans came, went, and so that happened. And we also know the people of the mud, There are many drawings in former riverbanks of people playing and experimenting with marking and molding fucking mud and trying to understand its properties to make a mark and leave the mark. What art is a very, very, very advanced early operating system, just like your computer. An operating system has a very simple purpose. How can I get what's in here, out there, in an abstract two or three dimensional model, and so other people can see it, and it will be preserved. So not just once. The dancers, I gotta love them. You know, they do this, and that's it. They go, but that's it. That's the end of my art until I do this again. The singers are beautiful that way. I'm a big opera fanatic, and I think just to walk around with this kind of incredible gift, the female soprano voice to me is one of the most extraordinary sounds on this earth that's been, anyway. What the hell was I just talking about? What was it? Mud in the river, the operating system. That's what a computer does. Art finds a way to get what's in here, out there, so other people will see it and know what you're thinking and be able actually to interpret it. And I don't mean in the stupid, boring way that we've become addicted to, which is always and only subject matter. Listen to me. Artists, sculptors of mud. First of all, use any goddamn material you want. What is this addiction? What is this addiction? You like cardboard? You like fabric? This one has great tattoos? Excuse me. Wake up. Hurry. You only have 100 years. That happened. That's it. Get to work. Don't feel sorry for yourself. You want me to give you some damn advice? Don't feel sorry for yourselves. I'm sorry you don't have a trust fund, motherfuckers. I wish you did. I really wish you did. I used to play the lottery, and it drove me partly mad. I would buy a lottery ticket, and then my week would be shot because I'd walk around going, I'm going to be a millionaire. I'm going to win. Hi, Chris. I'm going to be rich. What should I buy you? I'll get my family a car. I'll buy my uncle this, that thing he always wanted. I was crazy. I walked around New York for the first 10 years of my life there, filled with envy. Filled with envy and hatred the way you do. Money has made us mad. Money is making you mad. You will be poor for the rest of your life. I don't have a solution. I once went to an accountant. It was insane. He looked up at me. I was so proud. Is that funny? I went to an accountant. He looks up at me and he goes, have you ever thought of being a veterinarian? I was saying, you know, I dreamt I painted a goddamn American flag, motherfucker. I don't have a choice. So I left the trucks because it was worse than anything I could imagine, no matter how scared you are of trying. You big damn babies, no matter how scared you are, there has to come a point. And if it doesn't come, that's not my problem. There has to come a point where you must do what this 24-year-old gay guy in New York did, is do what you cannot avoid doing, what you were called to do, no matter how dumb. Do you know who Philip Guston is? Imagine the nightmare of being Guston, of being a pretty famous first generation abstract expressionist making little dashes and pretty pink fields. What a nice life there. You're poor, you're miserable, but come on. And one day he wakes up and he realizes, I want to paint one-eyed Ku Klux Klan figures driving around in convertibles smoking cigars. Would you do it? Do you have the balls or ovaries? Oh, he said a reproductive organ. Now, do you have the guts to change because you were called to? Poor Jackson Pollock, he only did this. And by the way, have you ever seen Jack the Dripper paint? He never painted like that. Here's how he painted. He had to smoke, because we all used to smoke. And I miss smoking every day. Right? Oh. Me, when I get my bad diagnosis, the first damn thing I'm doing. Oh, my God. 20 years ago, 30 years ago now, when I first met my wife, I hadn't smoked for 8 years. I wanted to show her that I was like a sex bomb with a cigarette. And in front of her, I went like this, took one puff, and I threw the cigarette out. And as the smoke hit my lungs, I said to myself, I'm going to dedicate the rest of my life to smoking. And I did. Like that. Anyway, Pollock painted like this. Okay, so you can make fun of him. He only did that for 48 months. And then he knew he had to change. Would you be able to change if you discovered something that had been there in the caves? The drip. The drip was there in the caves, remember? He noticed this. Nobody else ever noticed it before. No one ever deployed it as a vehicle, as a new operating system that might create new surfaces, new ideas of composition, and new ideas of internal scale, right? And a little thing we like to call abstraction. And we also must remember, because of these operating systems, that all art is abstract. When you are looking at Michelangelo, that's just fresco paint on cement, arranged in a way that you can interpret. You may not be able to understand it. And this is very important to me, that you grasp this next thing I'm going to say. You cannot look at art and say, and you cannot let anyone look at your art and say, but I don't understand it. First of all, you probably don't either. Unless you really get conscious and quiet with yourself and understand what was the lazy parts, what were the tricks, what are the sneaky things you stole? Yeah, I see. I can see when like cadmium orange moves through whole schools, you know, that this start, anyway. I lost my place. I forgot.
Jackson operating
system. Drip, what?
Understand.
Understanding. Who said that? It's twice Sheila Pepe, famous artist from New York, knew where I was. Thank you. Thank you. She's a great artist. Okay. What was it? No one ever listens to Mozart and says, but I don't understand. You do not talk about art that way. Mozart is something you experience. So is your clay art. So is your sculpture. I would tell you that Mozart was such a genius that he probably did understand his own work. He shows incredible consciousness. So does Mondrian, so do many, many, many great artists. And you look for that self-knowledge. Does this woman know herself? Or is she just dancing as fast as she can? The answer is always half. You are dancing as fast as you can because you're damn desperate. You want to make the art, and I find in my work, there's one of two things that will happen. I want to make it and get the fuck out of there as fast as I can. Like, oh, maybe I'm done. Maybe I'm done. Am I done yet? Is this done? Is this done? Done? And the other is I won't finish. And I keep over and over making something longer and longer. I don't know how it works with clay if you end up big fucking, you know, Towers of Babel. Build the Tower of Babel. Why hasn't anyone tried? Other than Trump. So, art is not about understanding, art is about experience. And you must probe your own understanding as deep as possible. You must come to terms with the fact that you're going to be poor your whole life, and you're gonna have to fucking get over that. You chose this life, or you can marry well. I'm not against that. I'm really not. I'm gonna offend some couples in this room right now, but find a lawyer. Do anything for your work. I tell my students, I don't give a shit about you. I only care about your work. I don't really care about you. I'm amoral almost. I really am. I only want to see more art. And I want to see what I call good art. Let's stop on the word good art for a second and be generous for 1 second. I could use a different figure, but let's be generous and say that 85% of the art I see is crap. Would you say that's being generous? Me too. I know what you're really thinking the number is, but don't say it out loud because those guys in the back will hear it. Hi, we love all of our work, I swear. No, 85% of the art I see is crap. In Chelsea, in the Met, 85% of the art I see, I drift past. 85% of the art made in the fucking Renaissance was shit. You find it hard to believe? I think we've discovered a constant in the universe. And I'm not kidding. But most of the art that was made in the Baroque that was no good, it's gone. So, 15%, to be generous, is pretty good, okay? What's so great about the art world, whether you accept this or not, is that it's all subjective. This is a stickling point for, especially men have trouble with this one. They like rules and standards. And what are you saying, Jerry, that there's no standards? And I'm saying, you have your standards, I have mine. When you go to Chelsea, New York, and see all the galleries there, the 15% of the shows that you thought were good are totally different than my 15%. We both came up with about the same number. You liked 4 shows, I liked 5. And then we begin a little thing I call blood sport. You know. Artists in rut, right? They present themselves. Carl Walker is a goddess. And then you go, and you go, Bryce Marden is a god. And then you argue about it, and you dislike each other, and then you break up with each other, and then you call each other in the morning. Isn't that great in the art world? You have a fight that can never be repaired, and then you're on the phone the next morning making a coffee date. Good art. You're looking for it, and I'm looking for it. I will show you how I look at art, because I'm recognized. Can I go on or should I stop? Are we good? I'm trying to talk soft so it doesn't echo too much here. Here's how I look at art. Let's say this is your sculpture made out of things called clay, cardboard, steel, paper, fans. I don't know. You assholes. Only one material a whole lifetime. Are you kidding me? What happened to you? Whatever. One of my favorite artists is alive right now is Jessica Jackson Hutchins, who lives in this beautiful town. Hello, Cleveland. And she uses couches. That's pretty ridiculous. Now, you can't, because she already did. But I don't think she's ever tried, like, an end table. Have you tried an end table, Jessica? Yeah, you're fucked. No end table. So anyway, here's how I look at art. I think people can recognize me now, so I'll go like this. And my wife always says, Jerry, why do you stand that stupid way? And I've never told her this, but it's because I once saw Jasper John standing that way. And I don't know, who do you imitate? Who are you imitating? Anybody come to mind? We're all imitating certain things in our physical being. And I always go, what do you mean I'm standing in a stupid way? So, and then if I think somebody's looking at me, I'll go, the movie, this hologram is thinking, people must be saying, Jerry looks good. Jerry looks hard. Jerry is working, you know. I'm gonna now show you how I always know when you're next to me. Always with an artist. Same sculpture made out of whatever. And here's how they look. Thank you. Tell me what your artists, tell me what you're doing.
I'm not the artist.
Oh, Jesus. What are you doing, artist?
Working in thread and embroidery on with clay, mixing media.
Oh, Jesus. I asked her the bigger conceptual question, what are you doing? Typical artist tells me about her own work. Insane, of course. Oh my God. I'm trying to ask artists, what are you, what? Technique. How things are made. In other words, can I boil it down as a writer? You're stealing. You're taking ideas. And you know what's so amazing about you? I hate you for this. Because my job is so hard. You can't believe it. Anybody here write other than me? Oh, kids, I'm so sorry for the writers. Hello, writers. Will you tell them how hard it is? It's a pain in the fucking ass. When I was a long-distance truck driver, my fantasy was, I'll be a famous art critic, and I'll be a millionaire. And I'm poorer probably than all of you in this room. Don't get pissed at me and think, you are not. That's the art world game. I'm poorer than you. Oh, no, you're not. I'm poorer than you. Oh, no, you're not. My underwear has two holes in them.
and my cat is dead. That's our stupid game. We're all about the same poorness. Don't you understand? I'm at the top. There's only about 11 full-time art critics. You see before you a dying breed. 5,000 of you, 11 of me. And we're not being paid, and we will be paid less. As I've written before, any art critics in this room? Very few. Hi. I love you. Any more? No, just two. Oh, God. Anyway, since we're not paid either, that's the point. You're free. You can do or say anything you want. You are not owned, and you will not be owned by anybody ever. There's nothing you can do to fuck up. It's not possible, other than like pissing in a fireplace or some idiotic macho act. You know, don't be an asshole. It's one of the things about being in the art world. I thought I could be rich, and I'm just as poor as you. I thought I could sleep with people, and I don't put off the vibe, I know. And if a critic sleeps with people, the problem with that is everybody says, you know why he writes about his work or her work or whatever. You're fucking up your work as you're doing it. I would say to artists, you should sleep with anybody you want. But, and the other is I thought I could be famous, right? And how many, who's the most famous art critic who ever lived, probably?
Jerry Saltz.
Jerry Saltz, I love you. Clement Greenberg. And other than avant-garde and kitsch, written in 1939, right before the Second World War, what have you read by him? All of you? Don't lie. You started one other long essay, but it was a pain in the ass. The most famous critic who ever lived is not read. So you will not, my work is for here now. It is not for the future. Criticism is very here and very gone. Your work, here's what artists do. You drive me crazy with this way. I made this. It's fiber and clay. Love me forever and give me a lot of money, way more money than it's worth. Don't get mad. All art is too expensive in my book, although I found a $12 work of art in one of the rooms today. Who showed that to me? Are you here? No, I hate you too. All art has gotten too expensive. If I were Trump, sorry for ruining the night again, I would take one zero off of the price of everything. That's it. I know it's ridiculous, so forget I said that. Sorry. But I think all art is too expensive. Since only 1% of 1% of 1% of 1% of all artists make any money, and they're mostly a couple of white guys, let's not be so obsessed with Jeff and Damien and Takashi. Am I forgetting anybody that's alive and working right now? I don't know. You don't like Matthew Barney? I love him. Fuck him then, okay? Or whoever, Carl Walker. I don't care who's making the money. Very few artists are making money. So stop being against the art world and artists for making money. Richard Prince, okay, you can hate him. I don't even care. These people all invented fire. You may not like the fire. Jeff invented fire once. Now he's like Ronald Reagan, howdy doody, Teletubby, running around the art world. Hi, how are you? Great to see ya. Oh, this is my wife's asshole, you know. He emptied himself out to be this thing, and this thing, once every 15 years now, makes something good. I love that big flower puppy that Coons made. I always thought if Osama bin Laden looked at that thing, all the evil in his body would have gone whap, whap. But that's me. You know, you think it's in your 85% of the bad art. You have to make an enemy of envy tonight. You've got to stop worrying about other people making more money. That's it. Envy will eat you alive. And cynicism, my children, will eat your work alive. What is cynicism? Here's my little definition. Cynicism thinks it knows. So-and-so's show. Well, you know why people are buying his work. It's because blah, blah, blah. Her show. Oh, the only reason she's in the Whitney Biennial is blah, 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 blah. Does cynicism know? No. Certainty is the nightmare we are living with today. People who are certain and you cannot talk them out of what they're certain about. Understand what Jerry is intimating? Certainty, bad. We, unfortunately, believe in paradox. Art believes in paradox, where more than one thing is true at once. Remember what my favorite American poet said, Walt Whitman. Do I contradict myself? Yes, I do. We contain multitudes. You contain multitudes. Your fantasies are disgusting. So are yours. So are hers. So are hers. Can't help it. You want to try to stop them? Because of a god or this morality or that? Be my guest. Start cutting yourself off. Do it fast, do it slow. But I'm telling you, there are many people inside of you, many truths. And one of them is you must make an enemy of envy and cynicism quickly. They will kill you. They're going to kill your work. I've seen it. You have to work all the time. I'm so sorry. I'm just so sorry. I've tried everything but working. It's a nightmare. And writing, as I was going to say earlier, is a bigger nightmare than even making art. You guys, you can listen to music when you work. We can't do that. I can only listen to shit music when I work that doesn't interrupt my thoughts. So I'm always listening to Enya. He's really laughing. It's disgusting. And people will say, Jerry, what are you Spotifying? And I'll go, Johnny Cash. Yeah. You have to work all the time. Work comes from work. Work comes from work. Work comes from work. Did you know that? I can't say it enough. It doesn't come from just thinking or just yammering constantly. You have theory. Now let's not beat the dead theory horse. Theory has been very, very good for this country. It brought us the civil rights movement, feminism, gay rights, multiculturalism. Before you fucking start dismissing all theory, which some people that work with the material called clay sometimes do. What I say to especially the older teachers that go, I don't like theory, I think it's blah, blah, blah. I always go, that's your theory, you big dummy. That's your theory. You read what you want. You do need to read. You do need to be able to be your best your own best spokesman. I know you can't really write. I can't either. But artists are allowed something that no one else is, that I'm not allowed. You don't have to make a damn bit of sense. You can play the psychotic card. You think I'm kidding? Just don't write this, and a lot of you do. I'm trying to resolve the difference between nature and culture, trying to balance a commodity existence with the simulacra, blah, 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 bam. You can write words like, I needed this show. I was up against a deadline. I fell in love with the person that kept walking out of my apartment. So I had to take that, whatever it is, just write it. I promise you, I'm on these stupid grant boards, and those are the only statements that are any good. And you can't just write, I need this grant because I'm dirt poor. You can, but that should just be the last line or the something, okay? So, work comes from work. You work your way through a problem that your work presented. Your work presents you problems, and you have to solve it with your work. You have to follow up your obsessions, every obsession, every one, your secret ones, your bad ones. If you're sewing all the time, I would ask, how come sewing isn't in your work then? Why isn't it all there? I would say that you, and this really applies to people in this room, you have to take your skill, which you fought so hard for, God love you all. And I mean that from the bottom of my heart. When I walked around all the displays in the big hall today, I wanted to be you. That's how amazing and sexy your world seemed to me. Oh, I hated you all. I almost wept. Which is sheer rage, really. They're doing this and that. You have to take skill and redefine it. You must redefine what skill is. Your own idea of skill, not just the idea. You have to have the idea of skill and the hologram's idea of skill. Do you understand me at least? I need this from you. I believe in that originality. It has to be yours. If I'm thinking too much of another artist in front of your work, there's a problem. Yeah, you might love de Kooning, but fuck you. If I'm thinking too much of de Kooning, you're in trouble. I need you to be able to fail flamboyantly. If you're gonna fail, go for it. Why not? Who the hell really cares? You big expert on the one thing in the world that nobody knows about, which is you. Fail flamboyantly. That doesn't mean with money. That means take a little risk. If you have to put a yogurt top in your stupid clay thing, do it. And if it doesn't work, do I care? Yes, I'll write about how shitty it is. And you better, I will. You've seen my work. And you better grow a thick skin. Who are you, a bunch of babies? Are you goddamn babies? You gotta grow thick skin. You guys, who here has attacked me online and I've yelled back? Anybody? Yeah, you, hi. I hate you too. Mwah. Now, I read so much shit about myself every day. My wife can't believe it. And she says, how do you do it? I said, I have skin like an elephant. I always think, and this you have to think too, nobody can say anything bad about your work that you haven't thought already 100 times worse. You could insult the shit out of me, and I would look at you and go, you haven't even touched the surface, baby. I want you to be able to redefine, before I wrap up, your idea of success. What is your idea of success? I know mine. when I became the truck driver and never made another studio visit because I'm not part of society, really. You've seen me online. Everybody says, oh, can I meet you? And I love that. But I always say, I'm not part of real society. I don't go out except to art shows. I haven't gone to a sit-down dinner in 20 years because I'm not socially adjusted. Like you. But artists have to do it. You got to sit there just like Chris was saying to me, going, how do you do it? And you're going to go, I don't know how the fuck I'm doing this. And you better talk to the person on your left for half the meal and that person on your right. Don't stiff either of them. Be a gentlewoman or a gentleman. Okay? Be nice. Everybody's in about the same amount of pain as you. But I've earned my way. I earned my way out of the social life. That's how fucked up I am. I had to really be alone, and I haven't gone out in decades. So I would say show up for everything, even if you hate it. Don't bring your envy, and certainly don't bring your cynicism. You bring your obsession to the table all the time, your honesty, your forthrightness, you try to be nice. And so what is the definition of success? If it isn't money, because you're probably not going to be very rich, but all of you will have phony baloney jobs like you already do, like I do, and you won't have to work in the trucks like I did. None of you are going to have to do that, and I'm proud of you for that. My definition of success is time. Time. Do you have enough time to work and feel miserable and have nightmares and need attention and want to be famous for the rest of time? If you have that time, I love you. And I love all the people in this room. I really do. I have a lot of hope for you. We need you. You're making it out of yourselves. There is no support for any of us. We are all making this up, I assure you. I have been to the mountaintop, and no one knows what the fuck they're doing. And that's freedom. Use it. Thank you, NCECA. Thank you. Oh, thank you. I love you.